My name is Shahé Mankerian. As the Mentorship Program Director, alongside Alen Simerjan, who spearheads the Young Armenian Poets Awards, we want to welcome you to the International Armenian Literary Alliance's third annual Mentorship Program's Emerging Writers Showcase and the Young Armenian Poets Awards. The spring of 2023 attracted over 30 mentees globally, making the total of submissions the most since our inception. It made the process of picking mentees and mentors challenging, which in retrospect is a good problem to have. We narrowed it down to 20 diverse individuals with varied literary backgrounds, and we matched them with gracious mentors who met with them at least four times throughout the summer. You will get to know 16 of them today. Calling them emerging voices would be misleading because these talented individuals are very active in the literary world. Keep these names in mind, look for them in publications, support them, because our rich literary tradition needs new bearers of the torch, particularly now when our homeland, Hayastan, is surrounded by active aggressors whose primary agenda is to annex a sovereign nation. Our writers must make noise when the news agencies of the world remain silent, which leads me to my next announcement. Today's showcase is being doubled as a fundraiser to assist four of our members from Artsakh. We have a forcibly displaced journalist, an Artsakh Sea writer, and two teenage poets who applied to YAPA this year from behind the blockade. We will split whatever we raise equally and help these four displaced women with 100% of the proceeds going to their survival. When we last spoke, none of these members had permanent housing. The Armenian government is providing each displaced person with very little money, so whatever we donate to help them get on their feet would be incredibly helpful. Also, please share the fundraiser with family and friends on social media. I don't want to prolong the introductory segment of our showcase, but we couldn't have mentees if we did not have a stellar, committed group of mentors. We are humbled by their willingness to commit and guide our mentees. Our mentors are accomplished writers, teachers, and professionals. It was quite noble of them to provide valuable time in the month of July and August and mentor our emerging writers. Dear mentors, you have made all the difference in the creative lives of our mentees with your care and guidance. Now, without further ado, I would like to introduce our first mentee, Sarkis Antonian. I will read his introduction prepared by his mentee, Jen Siraganyan, who is not with us for personal reasons. Jen writes, after teaching and mentoring high school and college age writers for over two decades, I can honestly say that Sarkis Antonian is one of the most remarkable poets I've ever encountered. Currently receiving a dual degree at Brown University and Rhode Island School of Design, Sarkis infuses his poetry with the eyes of an artist. In each poem, he collects images and places them on a page like a lyrical collage. Playing with form, he utilizes the full white space of the page. His language reverberates with freshness as he experiments with sound and coins new words such as anti-morn or boulder fist with incredible inventiveness. Each time we met, he revealed an extensive range in his subject matter, delving into the complexities of the Armenian diaspora, longing for a family member, feeling a body pulse with desire, or unpacking the violence in the everyday. As he continued to compose poems each week, he proved that he was never afraid to push himself into the strange and unexpected, the tragic and the beautiful. Mentoring Sako was one of the highlights of my summer. His talent is unmistakable, and I promise you that his words you are about to hear will haunt you. Without further ado, Sarkis.
First of all, I'm really grateful to be in the presence of this like high caliber of literary talent, to be amongst this like really invigorating like Armenian creativity and excellence. Being in this mentorship is such an honor, and I was really lucky to have been Jen's mentee this summer. And as a writer, I feel like this program was like, I'm never gonna forget how much it helped me to improve my craft and to sort of escape old habits and to look forward to my future life as a writer and to think of the next steps. And a message to Jen, I know she's not here, but you truly uplifted me this summer in a million ways, and I feel like you quickly understood my lens and lifted it and like put glass around it so that it could refract in ways that like I couldn't even have foreseen. And working with you on like formatting and clarity and the surrealism of writing and even like our crazy like word inventing in poetry reminded me why I love the medium so much. And it's primarily to like the invention of poetry or like the disruption and the unwrapping that comes with it. And having this like line level examination with like all the big picture scanning that we did just made me really confident as a writer. And I feel like this prolific outpour of work from me this summer is all because you were able to be such a good listener and to suggest things that challenged me in the best ways. And I'm excited to say that I've begun to assemble my debut poetry collection because of this program. And it's a very exciting new project that I'm really happy to put out one day, and I'm excited about it. So, and then this is a poem that Jen and I worked on together that was very different in the start, but I think has become one of my favorite things I've ever written. And it's about being Armenian, and it's called Scenes for a Failed Diaspora Boy. One, sundering mint leaves with all of your mouth in grandma's garden. Two, forgetting the lyrics fixed together for a soldier. Forgetting you're on a stage, disobeying the soldier, melting all the soldiers into one scab-stained liquefying mass of limbs, then walking to your next class. Three, pooling tears into each other on a children's place chair changing room because your nose cast a million particles of oil all over the mall boys, all on their clothes. Scratch off from your silhouette chunks of dark and force them into the frown of your shadow, soppy in the corner of the coffee bean. Boy shifting into toucan, back into boy. Boy nervous for picture day because his nose is too self-incriminating. Four, never opening cookbooks. Rejecting the sweets murmuring on the coffee table, your grandmother's knuckles as hooking as white roses in the darkness, as snowballs dismembered and glowing under a December blaze. Five, never listening to the speeches close enough, looking down as flagpoles gush upward like tantrums into the smog spiderwebbed across the city, taking steps. Half admiring how they become tricolored pieces of fabric themselves. You wonder how much this is doing for us. Next to you, a little girl's sandal breaks and she covers her ears and you want to go home. Six, ricocheting into every boy plus girl, boy plus girl, boy plus girl pairing in the middle school dance. Skinning your nail beds before anyone talks to you. Last week, your cousin prayed at the end of the table with a glorious speech that amazed everyone. His hair was almost golden. Beautiful fiance, your skin patinaed and brick hard. You are tired of second guessing. You split your eardrums next to the speakers all night. Fall in love, a girl, fall for her. The right way. Seven, Armenian men are brave. They are cartoon characters who write their own dialogue. They smoke outside and wait until worms encircle delicately the liquor slick marshes of their palms. They store guns in their stomachs just in case. You watch. Eight, guzzling the treats your mother sent to your college mailbox before they go bad. Each dust-lined pebble, crushing, savoring, believing, swallowing, honoring and protecting, savoring, savoring, eroding, finished, empty drawer. 9. Making your body into a horizontal line when someone asks if you've been to the country recently. You were 3. You forgot. You watch your mother buy a stack of lahmacun from the store and it wilts in the car, and then you put it in the freezer. You eat 2 and sully your lips with lemon and it doesn't help. Some part of you is always looking for something else. 10. Skipping Armenian summer camp. Walking in late to Armenian class in the morning, forgetting the alphabet a year out of high school, shaping your fingers into thin wires, then placing them above your heart at the pledge, then accidentally drawing out tiny red marbles, then sighing. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Arthur K. Sakin, and I had the pleasure of working with Karine Armen. She's a wonderful writer and person. Her devastating work is filled with humor as well, which brings absolute levity to her work. Karine is a photographer, a social worker, and a writer. She's taught as an elementary school teacher in Glendale for 32 years. She has a BA in photography and social work and an MA in education administration. She enjoys teaching creative writing and poetry to her second graders. Karine has written several articles for the Armenian Reporter, Armenian Weekly, and Asbed. In 2010, Karine translated her mother's self-help articles from Farsi to English and published them in a book called Inner Heaven. She has several poetry chapbooks. She's working on her memoir about cultural identity. She's absolutely astounding. Please welcome Karine Armen.
Thank you, Arthur. Thank you, everybody, for this opportunity. I learned a lot from Arthur in few sessions. So let me read. What are you looking for? I asked the New York custom officer who was going through my suitcase like a raccoon looking for food. He continued digging through the sides of my bulging bag that I had packed carefully in Tehran. It was August of 1981. I was returning from Iran after spending a few months there. It took me 4 years to see my family. I wanted to ask the officer, are you looking for drugs? But instead, politely, I said, please tell me what you want to see, and I can tell you where it is. As he picked up a shirt, a handcrafted frame fell on the ground. He looked nervous because he was not supposed to damage anything, but I didn't know that then. There was nobody behind me. I was the last person because I wanted to help an old Iranian woman who didn't speak English. This was my reward for being kind. The dark-haired officer kept going through my suitcase. I wanted to yell, "Don't touch my personal things!" I had a small carpet that fit nicely into my suitcase. He kept asking me about its price. I didn't know its value in the US, but he had the time to continue his exploration to harass me. Why didn't they distinguish between the supporters of Ayatollah Khomeini and others? Most Iranians wanted democracy, except the fanatic Muslims. Some Americans judged Iranians by the place of their birth and passport. Immigrants were like sheep with the same color and size. Our feelings, family, and cultural backgrounds were not taken into consideration. As the officer continued scavenging for problems in my heartbeat got louder. It was like a volcano that erupted and the words poured out of my mouth. I'm Armenian. I'm against Khomeini. Why do you give me a hard time? He didn't even react because most probably he didn't even know what an Armenian was. How much is this carpet worth? He asked again. I had to catch my flight to Washington, D.C. I had to end this. I said probably $400. He smiled like a fox and made me pay $35 custom tax. I had to walk to a cashier and return with a receipt. He had broken one of the locks. One side of my bag was open. How am I supposed to check this broken bag? He totally ignored my question. I dragged the suitcase down the corridor that felt like a colorful prison. I noticed President Reagan's portrait and remembered his election. On January 20, 1981, a few hours after his inauguration, the Iranian hostages were freed after 440 days of captivity in the U.S. Embassy in Tehran. During the hostage crisis, most Iranians who lived in the U.S. went through hell, living in fear. The U.S. government stopped processing residency applications for all Iranians, including Armenians and any Christian minority. I also felt hostage to the life conditions. I was exiled in the U.S. Right before my flight, I saw a big sign saying, "Welcome to the USA." What a nice welcome I got. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. The next person is John Ohan Danho, who will be introduced by Gregory Janikian.
Hello. I had a wonderful time this summer working with John. He's a very passionate man. He's passionate about his teaching, his students. He's passionate about literature. He's passionate about the Armenian diaspora and Armenia as a sovereign nation. And his poems deal with all those subjects. We worked on two things, John and I. One was how to make his poems more condensed and concise. And we did this by limiting some of his poems to maybe 10 lines, and then requiring him to use 5 randomly picked words within the poems so that his concentration became intensified in the poem, and he used these words kind of like stepping stones and being careful to what words surrounded them. The other thing that we worked on was how to make linear narrative less linear and less logical. And we did that by actually going through his poems and seeing what lines were inessential and by excising them so that the poems became more surprises because of these excisions and more open and gave the readers a way of participating themselves in the poem. And I think those two things really helped John, and I was wonderfully surprised by his improvement and gratified. So here he is, John.
Thank you, Greg. I really appreciate it. It was indeed an honor to work with you, and you've given me a new kind of poetic voice that I'm still getting very used to. So I feel like I'm being kind of birthed anew. And thus maybe some of these poems may feel a little clunky because it's kind of like I'm shaking off a bit of the womb, right? But I'd like to read, well, first of all, I want to say thank you to everybody. And yeah, my heart goes out to everyone in Armenia and Artsakh. So I'm glad we're fundraising. So if people can donate any amount, they truly should to help out. I'd like to read 3 poems, and I'm going to betray Greg a little bit because one of them is a little long, but he knows the one because I sent it to him and he was quite a fan. But so the first poem is titled, "I don't know what I'd title this, to be honest. I don't know how to write this poem. I don't know where each line will take me or what punctuation mark feels appropriate." I used a semicolon there. "Which parts should I repeat? Which parts should be shed? Should each line begin with an important word, or are transitive terms okay? Maybe I should have spelled okay out. My girlfriend got mad at me the other week when she flew back into LAX from Mexico because I texted her WB love instead of spelling out welcome back. She was only gone for the weekend. When I break for a stanza, is it because it's a new thought? Or have I judged it to be the right time? I can't really ask you since you're all muted on Zoom. And I have to wonder, do I overly consider my audience when I compose poetry? Well, hold on. Is it that I write poetry or that I compose poetry? One feels more important than the other, and that's the trap of synonyms. Now, you can't see this, but if you could, you'd notice how the lines never exceed a certain length. I generally like uniformity and visual space is important to me, like how I use each line as a stepping stone to the next, but the gaps have a lot to be desired. I tend to desire a lot. I desire fame, I desire recognition, I desire celebrity. I like this. And it feels like this entire process is selfish. My idea of the self is so topsy-turvy. In my mid-20s, I visited Japan with a friend. We stayed up drinking on the last night, and I remember him saying, I've known you for 10 years, and I have no idea how you see yourself. Tack on 10 more years, and I still doubt either of us know, but cheers. So where do I take the poem from here? I've been advised by my mentor, Greg, that to bring up the end isn't resonant enough. So I looked up synonyms on Word Hippo, walking into the trap. Sonorous, orotund, strident, plangent. That's a weird one. But I might have looked up the wrong resonant, so second attempt. Evocative, consequential, climacteric. That's a new one. And I think we're getting somewhere. But you know what they say, third time's the charm. My second poem is entitled X, and this is indeed in the practice of what Greg asked me to do in kind of condensing a lot of my thoughts and the non-linearity. In an aphoristic world, thoughts can't exceed 140 characters, or you risk losing out on a conversation you've been meaning to have. Why do people care about the Met Gala and how a bunch of celebrities decide to dress themselves? No good author kills off their protagonist unless they fooled the reader into thinking a character's more important than they really are. I think I've distilled the collapse of society into one single point, and it applies throughout history. 2D people trying to play 5D chess. Jarring bowel movements, neck pain, achy joints, loss of breath, and faded eyesight really betray me in ways I wish I'd have known. Each daydream finds a way to decorate the blank spaces in my heart. And my final poem, short, written in a bit of delirium, and I hope Greg hasn't heard this or read this. I hope that it's something. The poem called Was. The past tense really bothers me lately. That's what I thought while writing my godfather's eulogy. All the things he was and could not continue to be. I had to fill several pages and several minutes with what Epicurus called, quote, the grace of what has been, paired with the, quote, fear of what's to come. He was a cheeky bastard. I think past tense does that to a man. That's another eulogy thought, another chink in the chain, so long until I'm a was as well. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Gregory. Beautiful reading. The next person is Sarah Elgatian, who will be introduced by Susan Barber.
It's such a pleasure to introduce Sarah. I really enjoyed getting to know you, Sarah, this past summer, and you're such a lovely person, and your writing is so powerful. Sarah writes primarily lyric essays, as well as poetry. She also writes book reviews regularly. She works for the Midwest Writing Center in Iowa and lives in Iowa and worked for the International Writing Center before that. She's committed to a career in the arts, working in the arts to make the arts more accessible. And this attention to others comes across in her writing as well. Sarah writes about cultural identity, family, trauma, memory, and healing. And she has a real humility, a sort of modesty to her writing. But in her writing, this humility comes across as power too. It's a very interesting dynamic. She is a real master of form. So when you think of lyric essays, they could really be anything. And Sarah has a wonderful ability to write essays that that make the most of this freedom of form. So for instance, most of my work consisted of reading each essay. We worked on 7 essays and trying to puzzle out what the form was that Sarah was working with. It could be direct address, it could be an epistolary essay, mapping of time and space, a sort of lyric plotting, lists. And each one of these essays was really remarkable in the sense that it seemed to come out of the form, and then the voice came out of the form. So that was really pleasurable to figure out. In some essays, the form was fully fleshed out. In other essays, we worked to bring out the submerged form a bit more. And so that was such a joy for me. And I hope it was productive for you, Sarah. I won't say much more because I want to give you time to listen to Sarah's brave and bold voice and all of the soul searching that is really apparent in these essays. I'll just say one more thing. Sarah is also really a devoted reader, which she didn't tell me, but I can tell by reading her writing, and that's not the case with everyone. But once you take a look at her book reviews, you'll realize that as well. So thank you, Sarah. It was a real pleasure to work with you and an honor.
Wow, thank you so much. I'm a little overwhelmed. Thank you. I'm going to read an excerpt from a piece of nonfiction. Anique had a face like a knotted tree. You could hear dust on her tongue when she spoke, and she spoke like a crow, flat and shrill and always half yelling. Her life was built like a folktale with poverty, war, running for her life, refugees, exotic islands, and a mail order marriage to a man she didn't know. She held a country between her shoulders and 10 children in her womb. A life of survival taught her mind over matter in all things. Her morning sickness she treated by playing cards. Her hunger she treated by turning rocks into dice. Anik was Armenian, a survivor, born during a genocide, learned to read and write at a refugee camp in Syria, and came of age in Batista's Cuba. She had brown olive skin, thick, coarse black hair, and an undisguisable accent. But I only knew her seated in that chair by the door with a demitasse cup tilted toward her and a stack of frayed red-backed playing cards in front of her. Grandma Anik refused to speak English. She'd sooner speak Spanish to her grandchildren than say anything but insults in their native tongue. She spoke English fine through her thick accent at the corner store or with the neighbors, but never with her family. I can respect that now, though I'd never learned Armenian or Spanish. So we'd sit around her tiny table and play the only game Anik knew how to play, Crazy Eights. I kid you not, we once tried to teach her Uno and it didn't stick. They're almost exactly the same game. Grandma cheated. She cackled with her empty mouth wide while we had to draw great stores of cards, and when her hand emptied, she was not kind and she did not like jokes. Survivors of genocide are not soft people. They're not warm and welcoming. Trauma did not create cookie baking, blanket knitting grandmothers. Anik accepted nothing short of perfect, and we were terrified of the venom that came through her frantic foreign yells. She didn't share stories or dessert with her grandchildren, but she did love us. We didn't understand it, of course, but it was all she had to give. She tried to teach me Armenian from an ancient workbook she'd used to learn English sometime while stranded in Cuba on a 14-year layover between Armenia and the United States. She brought photo albums to the kitchen full of delicate, poorly colored photographs of herself in her youth, hair carefully coiffed in a stiff ivory tea-length dress. These, I suspect, were the photos used to sell her to the first Armenian in America who could pay her passage to Ellis Island. Many men, she told me, proposed marriage to her in Cuba, but she was the oldest sibling and had to bring her family to America. The first time I ever finished the food she put in front of me, grilled cheese in what I called a sandwich maker for 20 years. She started making it as soon as I arrived at her house. She harassed, complained, bullied me about my squinty eyes. Can you see? Where are you eyes? You blind? My eyes are tiny anime half moons, identical to her own. She grabbed my nose in tight pinches between her knuckles and cackled, "You lie, Pinocchio." The fat knob she used to jerk my face around mirrored the drooping nose of her youth. My faint mustache and dark circles under my eyes matched hers, and she mocked them relentlessly. Thrilled when I ate her food, she called me fat and took handfuls of my pot belly. This kind of love is not obvious to children, but it is love. It is love like armor, and so I don't want to deny my grandmother when people look at me. Her children were embarrassed by their dark skin and their poverty and their parents' thick accents. They changed the way they pronounced their last name. They called themselves Eastern European. They learned to eat canned vegetables and drink soda. They married blonde-haired and blue-eyed. Every step toward normal was a step closer to forgetting. That's where I'll stop. Thank you.
Unfortunately, her mentor, Dr. Tamar Boyajian, will not be able to join us. She just emailed me saying she's under the weather. Therefore, I will introduce Juliette by reading her bio. Juliette Hagobian is an 18-year-old poet and a writer from Los Angeles. She has been published in HPM, Surging Tide, and The Howl. She works as a poetry prose editor for Calopsia Literary. This summer, she was also a mentee at the Adroit Journal's Summer Mentorship Program. Last year, she was a YAPA winner, and I know personally that Dr. Boyajian was very excited to work with her. Juliette Hagopian.
Hello, everyone. Good morning, whatever time zone everyone is in. I'm Juliette. Thank you so much, Shahé, for such an amazing introduction. And I want to say that it's so amazing to be surrounded by and included with so many amazing Armenian writers, and seeing this Zoom with a bunch of creatives is wonderful and amazing. I had the privilege of having an entire summer dedicated to poetry, expanding my writing style and exploring all parts of the poetic, and with my help of my mentor, unfortunately, who was not here, Tamar Boyajian, I developed my ideas and ways of storytelling through a more mature figurative language, and creating that lens was very eye-opening. And today I'll be reading my poem Cleft, which discusses traumas unraveling in a domestic setting. Cleft. Thumbing bruises, I begin to sense the crimson of my body. The night is barging blankly. I am a daughter of erosion, slack of syllables from my father. These howls are ribbed. The neighborhood has its last cadence before it leaves undone on your chest. This is an opening. Scrawled across the floor, my father leaves long-legged like a monsoon. We are porous and airborne, pallid, refracting into spillage. The cleft of suburbia. He froths, web of rage bone. How do I dispatch silence into fluorescence? There is no right motion to wrangle. Let me melt this parallax. I am the ripple of progeny. I slouch until swollen. My father's shadow dissolves a half step behind him, navigating the darkness. The carpet tightens, divots of hurt. Every neighbor sags inward. I abandon myself to unjoint what is left of these folds, father and daughter, the greed of a final burning. I am torn between tongue muscles, fragmented, jilted, undoing, undoing. Thank you.
Thank you, Juliette, so much. Our next reader is Sarah Ignatius, and her introduction is by Dana Walrath.
Saying what a joy it is to be a part of this program and hear so many Armenian voices. It's really giving hope in a very bleak time. Working with Sarah this summer was an absolute joy. After years of using words in a linear fashion as a lawyer who built cases and as the executive director of Nasser, Sarah jumped into the creative process with vast imagination, gifts, and with humility above all. Many writers take comfort in the dictum, anyone can write, but only a writer can revise. And Sarah just was willing to go everywhere she needed to go. She used her heart, her intellect, and her openness to fully serve her story, The Devil's Kaleidoscope. I hope that you will enjoy her beauty and her depth as much as I have over the course of the summer that we work together. And I look forward to seeing this out into the world with the rest of you too. Thank you.
Wow. All right. Thank you very much. This has been an incredible experience for me, really like a dream come true as a aspiring fiction writer. And Dana has been extraordinary. She's brilliant and had dozens and dozens of insights that just go to the core of what I needed to, what I need to turn this manuscript really into a more powerful work of fiction. So thank you to Dana and to Shahé and Yala and all of you. I'm honored to be in your company. So I'm going to read from a chapter in the middle of my manuscript, The Devil's Kaleidoscope. And it's a middle grade novel. And the 12-year-old boy, Arakel, is speaking. Camel bells tinkle in the distance like leaves rustling in the wind. And I should say this is August 1915. Camel bells tinkle in the distance like leaves rustling in the wind. I open my eyes, expecting to find my friends, Vartan and Mehmet, beside me, watching a camel caravan lurch into town. Instead, bright white bones surround me, and I remember I'm still alive. My miserable escape plan failed and dropped me here in an underground cave where I spent the night with skulls, shreds of burnt clothes, and the lingering stench of death. The crazed guard dogs could come back any minute, if they're not here already. If I crawl out into the open, I'll be as easy to catch as a rodent snatched up in the talons of a hawk. Last night, I was ready for death to take me. Am I not worth the trouble? The camel bells ring out again. Their caravan will pass by soon. I scan the rock walls above the ledge I'm lying on and find a handhold and a foothold. Last night, I couldn't see them in the dark or care. I pull myself up, ignoring what I see, holding my breath against the smell, pretending I don't know what happened here. I grip the rock tightly with my fingers. My arms shake. I've gotten so weak, but I have to get out before the caravan leaves. If I slip, I'll crash to the bottom and won't have the strength to start again. Sweat trickles down my face. It's just one foot, one hand, another foot, the other hand, like a machine. I reach the top and collapse, sucking in fresh air. Then I lift my head. The morning sun is well above the horizon, lighting up the edges of thorn bushes. A line of camels kicks up sand and dirt into a haze near the ground, clouding their bony legs. The guards and dogs will be here in a minute. I glance around. Their camp has vanished, like I dreamt it. Uneven swells in the sandy ground are all that's left. That's why those bundles line the inside of the tent, packed up, ready to move at sunrise for more grass and water for their herds, leaving me in a death chamber they didn't dare enter. I stand up, my knee throbs. I hobble toward the caravan. My bare feet find every thorn in the ground. I stoop and quickly pull each one out. As I get closer, the caravan doesn't disappear. A man in front rides a golden camel. He stops and stares. I'm probably hard to miss. A bundle of rags walking in the desert. The camel drivers stop too. Their camels bunch up behind them. What if the caravan master hates Armenians and kills me right here in the desert? What do I have to lose? I walk toward him. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Beautiful writing. Our next reader is Byurakn Ishkhanyan, and the introduction will be by Dr. Jennifer Manukyan.
I had a wonderful time getting to know Byurakn this summer and reading her work. She's a Armenian writer based in Denmark and holds a PhD in psycho and neurolinguistics. She grew up in Soviet or post-Soviet Armenia, but she spent most of her adult life in Europe, and her writing bears those traces, delving into themes of identity and belonging. This summer, we talked a lot about the literary translation realm in the US, and we discussed sort of the nitty-gritty of publishing potential Eastern Armenian to English translators, presses, funding sources, things like that. But we also looked at query letters to press agents, and I had the pleasure of reading excerpts of her novel Tote Bag in translation. And from there, we talked a bit about in-text references that may require footnotes and endnotes for an American readership. It was a real treat to be paired with a fellow academic and a lover of languages and a learner of languages. So I'll hand it over to Byurakn. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Jennifer. It was a pure joy working with you this summer. And most importantly, I think I got the courage to start contacting agents and publishers. That I think that was probably thanks to you, I could do all those things. And today I will be reading an excerpt from my upcoming novel, The Tote Bag, which is actually in Armenian so far, but it may be translated to other languages in the future. And the excerpt I'm going to read is a scene between the two main characters, Siranush, an Armenian living in Denmark, and Zera, a Turk who grew up in Denmark. And the scene is set during the Artsakh War in 2020. "Does it matter who your leader is?" I asked. "No matter who it is, you want to eliminate us." "I want to eliminate you? If I had wanted to do that, I would have strangled you and thrown you into the water long ago." Zera laughed and stroked my cheek. "I hope this war will end soon. Innocent people are dying." "Sure, ask your government to end it soon," I said. "Mine? I haven't voted for Erdogan. I'm a Danish citizen. I have nothing to do with the Turkish government. You can demand it of your own. For instance, militarization is not a good thing, hmm?" She looked at me like I was a 5-year-old, and she was explaining to me the simplest things about the world. "What is your suggestion? Not to fight the aggressor? What has been done for peace?" "It doesn't depend on us, of course," Zara interrupted me. "In a patriarchal society, aggression towards each other is the only solution. And who suffers the most? The common people, while the patriarchal systems are measuring their dicks." "You're putting an equality sign between the aggressor and the victim," I said. "You're biased." Zara took a huge gulp from her wine and emptied the glass. "But I don't blame you. You're a side in this conflict." Her voice became more loving. "But if only you were able to detach yourself and see it objectively." "Aren't you on the other side?" I asked. Zara smiled, shook her head, and slid her finger around the wine glass. "I only want peace, demilitarization, and the end of patriarchy. I want justice to be established." And dreamingly, she looked at the ceiling. "The first step to achieving this would be recognizing the Armenian genocide," I said. "Oh, leave your nationalism aside. It was 100 years ago, but it's been 100 years that we've been waiting for justice." "I told you our countries need democratic leaders." Zara looked at her phone. "Well, I need to leave. I have plans. You know, if you need to talk, I'm always there for you." I stayed a bit longer. I was making a huge effort to hold my tears back. I sipped my coffee and continued watching the carefree Danes. I went back to Aram's. His wife, Mariam, asked, "Were you with that whore?" I didn't answer. "You don't have to tell me, I know." She showed me Zara's Instagram story from Lulz, where you could see my back. "Fruitless conversation," I said. "She doesn't understand anything." I warned you not to have any business with Turks. You told me it was 100 years ago," Mariam said. This was it.
Thank you so much for that beautiful reading. Our next reader is Michelle Khazaryan. I will read the intro for Michelle. Aida writes the following introduction for Michelle. "It was such a pleasure working with Michelle. She has a vibrant imagination and keen sense of humor that leads itself to magical realism. One of the many aspects of Michelle's writing I enjoyed was her ability to bring to life undiscovered and overlooked characters who very much need a voice and a place in the world of stories." Michelle?
Thank you so much. And I know Aida is not on the call anymore, but I just want to say thank you so much to Aida for being my mentor this summer and just supporting my writing and providing really valuable insights, not just to what I'm writing, but the writing process itself, and giving some life advice along the way. And I really appreciated it. I'm going to be reading, mostly worked on a magical realist short story this summer with Aida, but it kind of wasn't going anywhere. So I started drafting a new short story for a different idea I had. And so I'm just going to be reading my very rough draft from a scene from that. So this is a short story about an Armenian man that immigrates to Los Angeles in the 70s, and he picks up work as a bit actor for the first 20 years that he's here. So after his career in film, he's living his life in anonymity, and one day he gets a call from a talent agent. And so that's the scene that I'll be reading from. Vartan laughed out loud when Mike told him why he'd called. HBO had picked up a series on the Armenian mafia in Los Angeles. The producer was the guy that had done The Sopranos. Vartan didn't even understand what Mike was saying initially and had to ask him to repeat himself a couple of times. "He wants you to be in the show, Vartan. He's looking at bringing you in as a rival mafia boss for a couple of episodes. It's kind of like a homage to a legacy actor," Mike explained. "Sorry, I don't understand what you're saying. You're saying The Sopranos, this and that, a new show. I don't understand why you're calling me." "Okay, so the guy that's producing the show, he's a big fan of yours. He remembers you from all the detective shows you did in the 70s. Yeah, he says the episode you did in Collins and Jones, Omar, the guy that's a drug runner and owns the belly dancing club, he loves you in that. You know, you have kind of a following among some film guys. They love these character actors from back in the day. He wanted to have you step in as this rival crime boss for a couple of the episodes towards the end of the season. The whole show's about this Armenian mafia family and the patriarch. You know, he has to deal with taking care of the family and growing his empire. It's very Sopranos, you know, and we're feeling good about this show. I mean, this is huge. I really think this could blow up and become something. We're thinking when you come in for your first episode, it's really like, holy shit, it's this legendary character actor from back in the day. A lot of the young film heads love shit like that. What do you think?" Vartan agreed to meet with Mike and the casting director next week. He sat on the couch for a couple of minutes staring out the window. What did he mean he had a bit of a following? Who were these people? He had never been recognized anywhere. He drove delivery vans for Armenian markets now. The idea that the guy that had produced The Sopranos had seen him on TV and not just remembered him, but loved him enough to find him so that he could be in an HBO show, none of it made sense. The first time Vartan heard about the backlash was during one of his delivery runs. He had signed the contract and filming was supposed to begin in a couple of months. Arsen had a smirk on his face as he was looking over the delivery order. "Vartan Jan, I wanted to ask you something. You know that movie you're going to be in? I was talking to Ani and she's very mad, you know. She said it made us look bad." "What do you mean?" "I mean, she's saying this TV show, she's not happy about it because she's saying it makes Armenians look bad. She told me we are always criminals in movies. She's not happy such a big show is going to be about how Armenians are in the mafia." "Oh, come on. Who is saying every Armenian is in the mafia? This show's about some people, not every Armenian. Arsanjan, I can't believe Ani would say this. I mean, I'm like an uncle to her. I saw Ani grow up. Arsanjan, she's a very sharp girl, but I mean, come on, it's just a TV show. Vartanjan, for me, it's not a problem. I'm very happy for you and that, you know, God was really watching out for you. This is such a big moment. You can finally stop working, buy a house. Maybe you can even buy a house in Hayastan for the summers. I just thought, you know, it was funny. I heard the young kids are not very happy with this. Thank you.
I will read the intro for Rafi Mankasaryan. His mentor, Nairi Bakalyan, will not be with us for personal reasons. However, she has written this about Rafi. I am impressed by Rafi's motivation and his growing self-confidence as a writer. In reading his work, I noticed the raw, powerful, broad-reaching prose. It simply needed tightening to let the writing shine. I believe Armenians, especially queer Armenians, will find his project Welcome Home deeply relatable, meaningful, and moving. I have every confidence in Rafi's skill, and I believe his work, when it sees light, will go far. Rafi, I'm proud of you.
Thank you for the introduction, and I would just like to extend a distant thank you to Nairi, even though she can't be with us this day. This has been, the entire program has been one of the best moments of my life in terms of writing, and I would be and I'm overjoyed that I get to share all this amazing space with so many talented writers. The extract I'm reading from is from my currently in progress fictional story. It is about, it's a science fiction story far in the future about a human refugee who her and her family have had to flee a conflict zone of their home planet and settle in on an alien planet as official refugee status. The main character, Emma, is currently exploring a romantic relationship with another alien who does not have a physical form and is a symbiotic being. And the extract I'm reading from is one of their first dates, basically. The short wait for the summoned lift allowed Emma to check her terminal for messages. Nothing new. At least I won't make a damn fool of myself this time. Sports are a far better cover for my ignorance. She fidgeted in place as she recalled those first awkward conversations, the gnawing sensation that she was simply outclassed when it came to intelligence with Yex. God, I must seem like such a backwards rube to her. The shared interest of football came like a lifeline to a drowning woman. Once her cabin arrived, she selected her floor and watched the ground floor slowly shrink as she was whisked upwards before the doors opened behind her. The wide open spaces akin to an art gallery, the strange abstract geometric patterns dotting the walls gave it an almost surreal atmosphere. Thankfully, the artist-driven decor still included the odd bench and seat to rest weary feet. Emma bit her thumb as she checked her terminal again, the lack of new messages starting to resurrect the gnawing anxiety within her. Being stood up by a person who doesn't even have a physical body, that's a new low. A minute passed, and then finally a new message arrived. Just getting my equipment to the door. We'll be up shortly. See you soon. Emma's entire body untensed, trying hard to stamp down that ugly possibility she entertained a few moments ago. Of course she would need more time to get here. She probably has more mobility issues than me. Eventually, making her way through the elevator would be Yex in her containment tank, but also a Telsef handler wheeling the device. Escort when she's not in the clinic. He apologetically held up his hands. Don't mind us. We're not here to join you. We're just here to make sure that Yex is okay getting here and back. I'm for medical emergencies, and Larks is here for the physical kind. Emma glanced at the dark green furred giant that moved the portable tank, four eyes looking back down at her with a stony, unreadable expression. She nodded in understanding. Nice to meet you both. She looked back to the tank. Hi again, Yex. Ricardo gestured for the four of them to keep moving. I haven't set up her voice communicator yet, but I'm sure she says hi back. Emma checked her terminal and got confirmation from the woman herself in text. Unbidden, memories of going to the dentist filled Emma's mind as she slowly got her situated within the seated engine, placing her crutches to one side, and removing her translator chip from behind her ear, the screen having the usual warnings and disclaimers that outlined full-dive holostimulation technology. The hard two-hour cap seemed to be implemented both for fairness of patrons as well as the safety of the user. Right, Ricardo gave one last affectionate knock on the glass of Yex's tank. Your connections are all solid. I'll be here with my audiobooks. He gestured with his head to Lark's. He'll be meditating in the corner, so give us a shout and we'll come running. He excused himself, leaving Emma alone in her contemplative silence with Yex. As she wired herself into the engine via her translator jack and slowly brought the visor down to her eyes, the countdown was slow, methodical, as she was lulled into a trance. She steadied herself with long, deep breaths, as her senses slowly gave way into a visage of the past long gone. She found herself in the main thoroughfare leading to a grand outdoor arena. An unfamiliar sky and cityscape almost overwhelmed her. She looked around and attempted to adjust to the experience of being fully immersed in the holographic simulacrum of the past. Emma took a deep inhale through her nostrils and got the crisp, clean, filtered air from the library. No way they could replicate that, I guess. Once she noticed that, there were many small little details that harmed the illusion. The odd repeating individual, the fact the signage beyond the stadium grounds were illegible. Welcome to Neo Anfield.
I'm honored to introduce Sarah. Her work blew me away. She's already a formidable emerging poet. Sarah studied English literature and Byzantine history of art and worked as a teacher and freelance journalist before co-founding a specialist cello business with her husband and Eli and raising their two children. Highly commended in the 2019 Mislexia Poetry Book Society pamphlet competition and shortlisted for the Poetry Business Pamphlet Competition in 2016 and 17. Her poems have been published in The Rialto, Poetry News, Poetry Wales, Magma, North, Penny Platform, and a series of anthologies. Her poem, Egg Time, was a winner in the Poetry Society's Winter 2020 Members Competition on the theme of youth. In 2021, her poem, Somerset Soundtrack, was awarded first prize in the Spelt competition judged by Maggie Harris. And her debut pamphlet, Lemonade in the Armenian Quarter, won Best Poetry Pamphlet in the 2022 Saboteur Awards. And in spring 2024, a limited edition journal of cello-themed love poems entitled Slow Movement will be published by Coast to Coast to Coast. So obviously Sarah is already an accomplished writer. I was just so fortunate to be her mentor, and I felt like she could be my mentor. I learned so much about her complicated history, her struggles, losses, heartbreaks, triumphs. She honors her ancestors in her work, her grandmother Takuhi, her grandfather. Her poems about Lifta are so evocative. The reader gets to imagine her grandfather running through the pine trees, chewing their resin, for example. I learned so much from Sarah's point of view as the progeny of her grandmother Takuhi, the horrific experiences, the life-affirming ones, even the comedy and the tragedy that gives it all some levity. I love the specificity in Sarah's work, the attention to detail, the moments of self-realization and discovery that permeate throughout. She is on her way to a strong full-length collection, and it has been an honor to be a part of that journey. Ladies and gentlemen, Sarah Manatsaganyan.
Thank you, Armine. What can I say but thank you for the most tremendously productive, creative, warm, supportive summer with you. Armine is not just a fine poet, but a fine English teacher, and I've been privileged to have her feedback to my work, and also the focus of her interest in what I'm writing about was a midwife, to new poems this summer. I'm writing about my grandmother for this collection. She was born in Jaffa in Palestine at the turn of the last century. She married my grandfather from Jerusalem. They chose to live in Lifta, a Palestinian village outside Jerusalem, where they were very happy. So this first poem is actually called At the Virgin's Tomb. Imagine her fragrant hands hugging 100 beeswax tapers to her chest, 10,000 foot sore steps from Lifter to Gethsemane. She's wearing her friend Shukriya's dark blue gown and headdress heavy with silver coins to be like Mary, to fulfill her vow. Happy as a wineskin newly filled, she lays her bundle down, kneels on the top step and strikes a match. Watch her melt the first brown taper's base, snuffing the new flame on stone, holding it very still, waiting for the wax to harden. Yeah. Down every shadowy step to the Virgin's tomb, she plants a pair of candles, one on each side, and kindles them, all in thanks for her child. And Armene, as well as being incredibly inspiring, she also gave some homework to write in form. And she challenged me to write in different forms, including the pantoum. So this is a pantoum for Takuhi, my last poem. Pantoum for Takuhi. She loved the Lifter home that wasn't hers, surrounded by figs, pomegranates, suns. Her house was always glad with guests laughing as she imitated friends. Surrounded by pomegranates, figs, suns, she and Krikor settled far from the refugees laughing at her, mimicking her friends, her Muslim neighbours in the village. Far away from the refugees, they rented a new home in Lifter, befriending their village neighbours, welcoming family from Jaffa and Jericho. They rented a Lifter home, half-built, just outside Jerusalem, big enough to welcome family from Jericho and Jaffa to revel in the cool of a Lifter morning. Just outside Jerusalem, big enough to attract the attention of the militia who attacked in the cool of a Lifter morning, the village emptied of its people. To escape the attention of the militia, Krikor hired a truck, loaded it with furniture. Lifter was empty without its villagers. The boys huddled closer to their mother. They hired a truck and loaded it with loss. Krikor could not speak for fury. The boys huddled closer to their mother, and so they escaped to Jerusalem. Krikor could not speak for loss when they arrived at St. James's Street, and so they escaped to Jerusalem like refugees back to the family stable. They reached our home in St. James's Street. There was no space for Takuhi to weep, a refugee back in the family stable for the last years of her life. There was space for Krikor to weep when Takuhi left the home that wasn't hers for the last 10 years of her life, the house once glad with her friends. Thank you.
Next, we're going to Nancy Hagobian to introduce Rosa Melkumian.
I had the unique honor of actually having two mentees this session, so I wanted to give a brief shout out for posterity to Marina Terteryan, who's an incredible community organizer in Los Angeles, and her dedication to the Armenian community is so infused in her rich story, short story collections. So please watch out for her work. And it's my great pleasure to introduce Rosa Melkumian. Her openness and curiosity have been such a beacon of light in our work together. I always feel so uplifted after all of our conversations. She's writing a humorous, thoughtful memoir of life in Armenia that explores languages, identity, and intersection of cultures during this recent time of pandemic and war. Rosa examines the way language can both facilitate and hinder the ability to make connections with others, whether they be family or complete strangers. And we mostly talked about the process of creating a book-length work. And so Rosa was very brave and trying a lot of different approaches. And it was a pleasure to see her putting the pieces together. I learned so much from her about the gaps between languages and what they reveal, like vulnerability, trauma, sexism, and other isms. And all, in that kind of voicing of the silences, very hopeful work. To get a sample of her rich work, you can check in with Rosa's Substack newsletter. It's called Noteworthy with Rosa Mankerian. So go ahead, light it up, Rosa. Thank you.
I just wanted to say working with Nancy has been so wonderful. I truly, I feel like I've made a really good friend. And even just in our meetings, when if I would come in feeling like I didn't have any ideas, Nancy was such a wonderful sounding board to kind of bounce things off of. And I found that I found that I actually had a lot to talk about. So yeah, I'm going to read a poem actually that I wrote while I was working on this memoir. So it's not in the memoir, but it's very much the same, touches upon the same themes. And it was fun writing a poem because I don't really write them, but it just kind of came out. So this poem is called Please, or I Am Not a Local. Here they say Khandruman. I have lived here, so I learned to say Khandruman. When I walk, when I pass somebody by, when I ask a question, pitch rising so as to sound as feminine and gentle as possible. Or shorter, Khandrem, Vor Khandrem, tactfully tacked on to the end of the sentence, syntactically succinct, trying to play as a local. I will never be a local. No, I will never be a local. So if you please, please don't ask too many questions and poke at the shell I've fashioned myself, cocooned in the forced confidence with which I utter basic phrases, only to falter in the foray into complex thought, complex sentences, syntactically flawed, stuttering and stumbling. This is language. We order chicken and he says, Khandrumam. But sometimes I slip and say Hajis, and that's how they know, he says, that he is not a local, that he could never be a local. Western and Eastern, he speaks both, cocooned in knowledge, in education, in specialization, in books, only to falter in his reflexes and let leak the truth that this Armenian is not his Armenian, and his Armenian is not this. Deja vu, as I remember another man who ordered us chicken, different place, Lebanese owned, Hajis. Not a slip, but a certainty, sureness, cocooned in confidence, pride, in knowing he is not a local. My greatest misconception, perhaps, was thinking of my father as a local. Or maybe my greatest mistake was simply not thinking, not seeking knowledge so that I could know. But when we came as a family to Armenia, I knew without needing to seek, as he began to speak a language I'd never heard him speak, with taxi drivers, with waiters, a language he had learned as a child at his own risk in Soviet Azerbaijan, surrounded by hatred, but cocooned in the safety, in the unity, in the unifying power of the Russian language, his first language, Armenian second. To the waiter, he says, Khandrumam. To my mother, he says, Pajalista. I learned to say Pajalas the years before Khandrumem, and I know that Russian is the colonizer, but it is familiar, so familiar. I utter the words Khandrumem, and every time I force the kh, but Pajalasta is soft snow melting on my tongue. I am not a local.
Next, we have Victoria Harwood Butler Sloss reading her mentee's work, Asbed Pogarian's work. So Victoria, if you're ready.
Yes, hi. So first I wanted to introduce how I became a to Asbed, I was asked, you know, to choose between a few people, and I wanted to choose somebody who was very different to me. So having a man who had written the story that was very unlike what I had written was one of the attractive things to me. But the funny thing is that the minute I started working with him, I realized that we were the same age. We had 26 at least friends in common on Facebook. He had lived in Cyprus, spent time at the Melkonian school, and I was in Cyprus while I was mentoring him and finding out that I was having drinks and coffee with half of his friends while he was in Gosh in Armenia. That's something also that I should mention, which is that Asbed is a teacher and a lecturer and a writer, and he also has set up in Gosh in Armenia and is, as they say, assisting in strengthening Armenian villages through deep engagement. And so this is what he was doing all summer, and we were trading. So the first thing I did is, Asbed wanted me to help him with his query letter, so I said, let me read it first. And I was so blown away by how natural the writing was and how realistic it was, that by the end of the story, and I'm not going to give away, you know, plot details, I started to get worried. I was like, wait a minute, there's a lot of dramatic stuff that goes on in here that needs to be addressed. And so I called him up, and he reassured me that the whole book is fiction. So without further ado, I'm going to read a little bit from his book. He's being shy, so he asked me to read for him. This is from his novel, Loving Father, Bitter Son. Keeping a secret about someone's death you've caused is a torturous burden to bear. Just ask me. I know it well. I've kept one a long time, until now, except for sharing it with my mother and sister. But that doesn't count, because when I was sharing it with them, it was at their gravesite. They had been dead for over a decade. My mother, Zabel Durian, died of a broken heart at our apartment in Pasadena, 9,000 miles away from her birthplace of Addis Ababa. My sister Margot died 2 years later of a drug overdose. She had just turned 19. While the coroner's report listed drugs as the cause of Margot's death, it really was not. Coroners may be expert at detecting drugs in dead people's bodies, but they're clueless to the pain lurking in their hearts. Margot died of a broken heart too, just like Mum. The only difference is that she used drugs to numb the pain she carried inside, prompting the coroner's clinically accurate yet highly simplistic conclusion. My sister and I had gone through the same ordeal, but the events that befell our family after we fled from Ethiopia scarred her much deeper. As a sensitive 9-year-old, she became confused, unable to comprehend the extreme hatred Mum and I so suddenly, from one day to the next, developed towards Dad. She knew how I adored our father, and the swift deterioration of my affection for him rocked her world. Her confidence shattered, sending her into a shell, terrified of showing any emotion for fear of losing her only remaining parent, our mother, on whose shoulders her precarious world rested. Within days of Mum's passing, my graceful sister turned into a rebel I could hardly control. No matter how hard I tried, I was powerless to stop her meltdown. Even before Mum's body had time to settle in its grave, Margot began drinking and doing drugs with people she had once disdained, with an urgency as if to make up for lost time. Margot's transformation into a possessed individual reminded me of the time when, as kids back in Addis Ababa, we witnessed our father exorcise a demon that had possessed Zoditu, our cook's wife. Zoditu had been yelling all night long, her eyes rolled up in her head, shaking violently on her bed like a frenzied beast. I vividly remember Margot and me peeping through the door late at night into our cook's quarters, as a naked bulb hanging from the ceiling illuminated the room with a faint hue of orange, casting long shadows on the walls and floor, making the experience all the more terrifying. Dad held a plate over Zoeditu's head with alcohol-soaked burning cotton he'd shaped into a cross, reciting the Lord's Prayer. Zoeditu growled at him, her voice hoarse as the devil's, fighting to free herself from the grips of her husband and our mother to tear him apart. We were both traumatized, but my sister's reaction to it was much more severe. Margot didn't yell or scream like Zoeditu, but I could sense a similar force possessing her. Out of desperation, I even tried Dad's burning cross. One night, as she lay on the floor, passed out and drenched in her own vomit, I held a burning cross over her head. To my dismay, it had no effect, neither the Lord's Prayer nor the combination of both. The demon residing in her didn't even budge, let alone leave. Her descent was irreversible, and there was nothing I could do. I often wonder how I managed to survive our family's turmoil. Was it because I was 5 years older than her? Was it my gender difference? Was it simply fate? I haven't figured it out. Maybe you can. That's it.
Thank you, Victoria. Let me say a few words about Victoria. I was really honored to be paired with Victoria, and I thank Ayla for that, because she has a deep understanding of story and character, and as everyone knows, a novel, especially a long novel, has so many moving parts that if one part is weak, it will bring the whole thing crashing down. So she, with her deep understanding of story and character, she pointed out some of the weak sections, and we worked on them together to strengthen it. So hopefully now it's a much stronger novel. And in addition to that, she gave me some pointers about finding an agent, which I haven't still began working on it because I just returned from Armenia. But that will be my next project. So thank you to Victoria and Ayla, everyone, for this wonderful opportunity. I'm grateful.
Thank you, Asbed. Thank you, Victoria.
Thank you.
That was beautiful reading. Next, we have Rachel Reed. I will read Rachel's intro for Ida. Ida writes the following introduction. Rachel was wonderful to work with. I admire her devotion to writing about family and cultural traditions, how they morph and change through the passing of time. I also enjoyed her well-drawn characters, how she writes about them and through them, keeping in mind their flaws and virtues in relation to themselves and to one another. I'm really looking forward to the culmination of what she brings together. Rachel Reed.
Thank you, Shahé. It was such a pleasure working with Aida this summer. She was really encouraging and patient with my glacial progress and family obligations. So today I'm reading an excerpt from a novel. To set the scene, 88-year-old Nevart is back home after recovering from a hip replacement. She lives with her great-nephew, Haig, his wife, Ruth, and their two sons, 17-year-old Brian and 8-year-old Jamie. It's Easter morning in Pasadena, California. Brian returned with her water cup. Nevart tried to pat his hand as he set it down, but missed. The boy moved fluidly for someone prone to confrontational outbursts. Earlier that morning, she'd overheard him ask Haig why the Easter greeting was taped to the fridge. "Don't you speak Armenian?" Like many things Brian said to his father, it held an undercurrent of accusation. She had braced herself for an argument, but the needs of the day had diffused it. "Yes," said Haig slowly, "but I only say that once a year, and we're hosting. I have to get it right." A mumbled response. "Come help me find the tablecloth in the garage. Your mother wants the yellow one, but I didn't see it in the Easter box." They hadn't found it. The table was bare, with supermarket bouquets guests had given Ruth and herself making poor substitutes for centerpieces in mismatched vases. Jamie hadn't wanted to decorate the Easter tree or help dye eggs. He was still sore that their family trip to Legoland had been canceled after her fall, another reason she was surprised to see Jamie circling her again. That was a small thing to be grateful for. His need to share his thoughts with someone often made him forget that his grudge against her for ruining a long-promised pilgrimage. And, unaware that he didn't know how to talk to her, he just talked. "I don't like ham," he announced, appearing once more by the side table. "Do you like ham? Well, I only like the edges, the crispy sweet part." Nevart smiled at him. "That is my favorite part, too." She had no idea how she was going to eat anything on offer today. Her arms shook and her appetite had fled in the convalescent home, if not earlier, in the hospital. Maybe she could take a nap, avoid the whole lackluster affair. That's what old people did, napped. It was the perfect escape. "Why can't they make just that part then?" Jamie fiddled with a toy, trying to get it to change shape. "I'm hungry. Why do we have to eat so late?" He had long since pulled off his clip-on bow tie. Lazy and impatient, this one. "It's work to make this meal, a lot of work. You can wait. The bed egg will be out soon. Not that you have any room. Your stomach is chock-a-block with gumdrops and jelly beans." Jamie giggled and reached for the candy dish. She slapped his hand away. "Enough." She saw in his smooth face the switch to fearful deference and regretted losing her sole companion for the day. "Well, let his parents set the limits." She pointed toward his toy, ignoring her arm's tremor. "What's this?" He mumbled something brief. She extended a jelly bean. Jamie began to share details of his plastic world. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. Next, we have a video. Before the video, from Lilly Torosyan, we have Lola Kundakcian, who will introduce her mentee.
Hi, everyone. It's great to be here and to hear everybody's work. What a great, great program we have. My mentee, Lilly, is a freelance writer based in Connecticut who has traveled extensively in Armenia. Her writing focuses on the confluence of identity, diaspora, and language. She uses Armenian intermittently. Her articles have appeared in publications such as the Armenian Weekly, HPAM, and EVN Report. Aida Zilelyan, Arthur Kaizakian, and I had the pleasure to meet her when we read during Arthur's book tour at KGB Bar in the East Village. And Lily is currently working on her inaugural poetry collection. I enjoyed very much working with Lily. We focused on the voice editing and expanding musicality and visuals in her poetry. And I hope to see her in print very soon. Thanks.
Khahor is one of the most delicious Armenian words. I adore how the khaz and ghaz vibrate against the roof of the mouth. When my friends ask how to say something in Armenian, this is usually my go-to. Khagogh, khagogh, khagagh. Peace is just one vowel away. Split the bunch. I watched the live stream of a pregnant wife picking fruit from her garden. As she gets up, her child kicks. Savor the juice. Experts tell us that Artsakh is 2 months away from famine. Their dusty notepads from Derzor, now black headings on an Excel sheet. Starving Armenians, my friend's grandfather called us. Our eyes adjust to the rot, the fruit soured in the middle. Breasts caved in on a life, lying in a ditch, sheathed by a mob of curls. Flies nestled on bone-dry lips, the dead never more alive than in the stomach, grape-red belly smothered by the sun. Starving,
Sovama. Sov, hunger. Ma, death. Hunger, death, death, hunger. Which came first? Dangle the seeds. Try to remember. No. Bend back. Find the vine. Swim in its veins. Tsov. See. When Armenia had one. No, many coursing through her legs. When Armenia was Urartu. Like Tsov. Like Kharar. Like Kharor. Extinct like Kharor. A linguist's way of saying starved. Sea and peace and grape, all starved. They don't belong to us anymore. We reach for something sweet, but the tides recede on swollen bellies.
Thank you, Lily and Lola. Next, we have the founder of IALA, our fearless leader, Olivia Gantragian, who will introduce her mentee, Lusine Vanyan.
Thank you, Shahé. First, I wanted to thank everyone who's donated to our fundraiser to support our writers from Artsakh. Thank you, too, to all our mentors for donating your time to these inspiring writers. And to Shahé and Hovsep, who have run this program so well. To our mentees, it's not easy to read in front of an audience, I know, and I just love the way you are all cheering each other on. This is your literary family now, and I hope you continue to support and lean on each other. Without further ado, I want to introduce my brilliant mentee, Lusine Vanyan, a writer, scholar, lecturer, and translator from Artsakh. She applied for our mentorship program from behind the blockade, and when we first spoke, she said she had resorted to eating the leaves off the mulberry trees. But she wrote on, gathering stories from the people around her to paint a picture to the world of the many characters of her homeland. Writing through this crisis was not easy. Lusine had a full-time job and struggled to write at night with the frequent electricity blackouts. When I spoke to her on the road out of Artsakh, stuck in never-ending traffic as she was forced to flee her home, I, of course, was worried about her well-being. But she said, Olivia, if I edit my story, will you look at it again? It would be my honor to continue reading Lucina's work for as long as she'll have me, because she writes with such a keen eye for not only the beauty that surrounded her, which she describes in evocative detail, as you'll see, but also for the specificities and quirks of character that make those who populate her work so distinctive. I'm so proud of you, Lucina. Thank you for inspiring me, and I can't wait to see how far you will go.
Thank you, Olivia, and thank you for your skillful guidance. And this was a brilliant opportunity for me to grow, and this was something I was looking for. And what I'm going to read is the setting of a short story about a doctor who came from Kiev, from the Ukraine, to Stepanakert, where he was born. Ruben's elegant dress shoes clicked on slabbed pavement as he approached the Republican Healthcare Center in his navy suit. He passed a memorial just outside the center, erected as a final resting place for World War II combatants, some of whom passed away after being transported to this hospital from the battlefields. The memorial had gradually expanded during the war in the 90s and after regular border clashes. It was surrounded by the bush-covered hills with a fantastic tinge of lush green that entranced Ruben. Soon he got to the hospital's fountained leafy portico. The morning sun peeped into the green glassed halls and the already crowded waiting room of the gastroenterology division. The land, once known for robust health and long life expectancy, along with the Abkhaz in the region, now had a soaring mortality rate because of war and simmering conflict. The sick flooded the hospital every morning and were an inspiration to Ruben. He was imagining his plunge into the day's work with good grace. His treatment increasingly healed them, challenging the assumption that GI patients never fully recuperate. Ruben's passion for his patients baffled some of his fellow physicians who suffered from emotional burnout and were often alienated from the sick. The other doctors thought he was crazy to leave a prestigious hospital in Kiev for the provincial job with mismanaged and heavy workload in this small enclave where he had grown up. But they had never left Artsakh and didn't understand how, even when gazing out at the golden tops of Kiev's Pechersky Lavra, watching the sunset over the Dnieper River, Ruben had longed to be here in Stepanakert, eating his mother's jingalopats or chatting with his dad on politics while roasting barbecue in their backyard. Thank you.
Next, we have Alen Voskanian, whose introduction will be given by one of our friends, Raed Varaz, who was his mentor. Raed?
Hi, Shahé. Thank you. Thank you, Yala. Thank you to all the mentees and creatives and mentors here and in the future. It's really empowering being with all of you. I had a blast working with Alen and his poems, editing, expanding, weaving together. He's full of love for his life-giving family, husband, kids, mom, his surroundings, senses, community, being a doctor. And he has a book, Reclaiming the Joy of Medicine, Finding Purpose, Fulfillment, and Happiness in Today's Medical Industry. Thank you, Alen, for trusting me and working together. Looking forward to your poetry in print. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you to Yala, and a big thank you and Shinar Hakaluchun to Harar. I just learned so much from you, Harar, and your love of Armenian language and putting up with my way of speaking Armenian, and learning you from the way you speak Armenian made me realize how much we have in common. And also going last reminded me of my Armenian elementary school. I'm going to read three poems. The first one is The Mother Ocean. Ocean's vast and calming waters are reminders of childhood bats filled with bubbles, rubber duckies, and memories of past. These waters know how to bathe and entertain my sorrows. I can join seagulls and fly freely in the shape of a V above the ocean. Salt-kissed breeze of the ocean knows how to rewind my mind. I am waddling across the shore, hand in hand with my mom, aimless, barefoot kid, making footprints on the freshly flattened sands of the ocean. Ocean's repetitious rolling waves, like birth, like death, like birth, like death, ebb and flow like the ups and downs of life. Joyful kids growing up with hope, and ending up without homes, sleeping between bushes, facing the ocean. Meditative melodies of the ocean muffles shoulds, coulds, and musts, quieting disapproving voices inside, liberating me. I sing, dance, holler, and scream all the way to the peaceful end. My mother, ocean. So the next one is titled, What Do Gay Men Want? And this poem is inspired by Kim Adonisio's What Do Women Want? I want pink glasses. I want them stylish and loud. I want them, and I want to wear them all day, even when it's dark. I want to wear them with shorts and flip-flops, to wear them with suits and ties. I want to walk down Santa Monica Boulevard with my pink glasses past the Abbey, with its fake facades, loud music, and dancers where different sorts of nuns and sisters worship their truths. I want to strut into boardrooms, pink glasses on, like I'm the only man who is brave and confident. I want these pink glasses real bad. I want them on my face to force you to face your fears and your bigotry. I want you to know that I don't care what you think about me, even if I wear a red dress with pink glasses. When I find these pink glasses, I will snag them like the last rolls of pandemic toilet paper. I will wear them in the store as soon as I find them. I will wear them to hide the tears that come every time a young soul is harassed, mocked, or forced to leave this earth earlier than they would. I will wear them high on my head and keep my head high so I don't fall. I will wear them, and heck, I will keep them on from that moment on. And the last poem is titled In the Empty House. I boil green garland lentils for 10 minutes. I boil white whirling basmati for 5, adding yellow Persian saffron. With your wooden spoon, I cover it and let it cook with steam in your favorite heirloom pot, as you told me, Mom. During Sunday family dinner, your grandkids join in and reminisce. Visiting Van Gogh Museum, swirling colors, turbulent strokes. His stars are garlands in the sky, keeping his night alive. You are not alive, and I want to keep you alive. Lonely in the crowd with my family, as they eat chocolate croissants, that aroma of freshly brewed coffee from the cafe, it was your favorite. The first time I visit your empty house, your teacup still has some dark amber tea, and I hold the Earl Grey tea bag, your last. I remove your dirty clothes from the washer. I close my eyes. Your Chanel perfume. I search for that circle-shaped bottle, finding it by chance in the donation box. Citron, jasmine, teak wood. Dad, they say move on, but I can't. Thank you.
Next, we are making a transition to another exciting set of readings. This is the part where we present the young Armenian poets. This project is spearheaded by Alen Semerjian. Alen is a friend who is a teacher, musician, and a poet. He runs the Young Armenian Poets Award with passion and dedication. Alen, take it away.
Thank you, Shahé. Quite a dynamic family you've assembled here today. I just kept thinking of like what evidence of beauty, what evidence of life, what evidence of resolve. I'm just going to say a few words about the Young Armenian Poets Awards and then introduce this year's recognized young writers. I think one of them may not be here. I was looking at the poll. We can address that in a moment. I'm thankful that IALA continues to make space in its annual Emerging Writer Showcase for the Young Armenian Poets Awards. It's an honor to serve as its founder and director for the past 3 years. This year's prompt asked Armenians between the ages of 14 and 18 to submit poems that grapple with the notion of visibility as it relates to Armenian identity and experience. So how visible are Armenia and Armenian issues on the world stage? What is the extent to which we feel visible as Armenians in our respective communities outside of Armenia? We started this when the blockade was happening. And then, of course, you know, we didn't realize how tragically poignant and fitting this focus would be months after, with the devastating events that have occurred in Artsakh and also how invisible so many of us perhaps have felt, particularly those on the ground whose lives were turned upside down and who are grieving deeply today. So in the midst of these incredibly difficult times, we were inspired actually by the work that came in from around the world, including this year we had pieces in translation from Armenia and Artsakh. This in and of itself is a testament to the power of poetry to help us make meaning of our lives. And to, as Khazaryan writes, illuminate some dark corner of the universe. So I wanted to just thank all the people who got the word out about our contest, all the teachers, family members, neighbors, friends, people in our network who shared the call around the internet, strangers, acquaintances, far and near. We are all part of the same cause now. We're grateful, and we absolutely could not have an initiative like this without you. I want to thank our phenomenal judges who read with precision, compassion, and wisdom again this year. Gregory Janikian, Armine Ignadosyan, and Rafi Arkanyan. It is such a pleasure to work alongside you as we move through the conversations. Thank you to Hamas Kayan's cultural arm, the online website HPEM, and Shahen Arabohlian in particular, who spearheaded our partnership and did so much to publish and bring into the fold these new young voices you're about to hear. Thank you, Shahen. Thank you, HPM. Thank you to Hofsep Markarian, the IALA program director, for all the vital work and the back and forth with me and our founder, President Olivia, who was the inspiration behind the prompt, actually. So thank you, Olivia, and everyone at IALA who helped support this initiative to center our youngest and our brightest makers. They are our future, no doubt, the champions and their supporters. I want to make a brief but important announcement now as well. The family of poet, musician, and artist Tamar Asadurian, who passed away in 2020, has been gracious enough to extend support annually for the Young Armenian Poets Award. Their support will allow for a significant increase in next year's monetary awards, as well as the establishment of some invaluable resources to help publicize and create networks for our work, which will ultimately extend our platform to more students around the globe. This is invaluable support and work. Going forward, the Young Armenian Poets Awards will be held in honor of Tamar Asadurian. And in addition to monetary prizes, students will also receive a copy of her stunningly titled and aptly titled book of poems, I Remember You, My Future, which was published by the Narragansett Art Institute in 2022. In fact, I think we have plans for this year's winners to receive a copy of the book as well. So huge thanks to Tamar Asadurian's family, and more news to come. That just great news. And finally, I want to reiterate that today's showcase is also a fundraiser for four Artsakhsi writers from our community who were forcibly displaced from their homes. I think that call has been put out in the chat a few times. They found refuge in different regions of Armenia. Currently, 100% of the proceeds will be split equally to support them as they navigate their new respective presence. A pair of young writers, best friends from Artsakh, shared in their introductory submission notes for the contest something that left an indelible impression. They wrote, "We turned to poetry as necessity, both as a salve and a weapon for us." They wrote that in their introductory notes. Poetry as necessity, both for and against, a salve for pain, a weapon against our vanishing. I feel like I can see these young voices visible and true clearly in their words. And perhaps more importantly, I can see a glimpse of what they have seen and therefore understand better, love better, fight and act better, grow better. So this is the work of poetry, all literature, literary making. And I think a fine segue into hearing from our four recognized young writers today. I will introduce the three winners and they will read their winning poems in alphabetical order, their last name, and then I will introduce the honorable mention as well. I don't know if the honorable mention is here. We'll address that in a moment. I'm going to ask that the three winners just sort of unmute themselves and get on after, one after the other. We'll read in alphabetical order by last name. So I'm going to introduce the three winners now, and then we'll do our honorable mention afterwards. Vladimir Mkrtchyan from North Belmore, New York, USA, who goes to MEPM High School. Vladimir is 16 years old. That's one of our winners. And then Isabel Nargisyan from Burbank, California, USA, goes to Burbank High School. Isabel is 17 years old. Sophia Viana Agluk from Manhasset, New York, USA, goes to Manhasset Secondary School. Sophia is 14 years old. And then if our honorable mention is on the call, is Alessandra Hagobian from New York City, New York, USA. And Alessandra goes to Horace Mann School and is 16 years old. So without any further ado, Vladimir, do you want to read your winning poem?
Hi, thank you so much for hosting the Armenian Poets Award and everyone involved. Before I do read my poem, can I address something about it? I think that there's something important that needs to be addressed.
Sure.
So in the wake of what happened last year in the fall of the brutal killing of Anush Apetyan, the soldier, it really shook me to my core because it was horrible and very brutal. And that is who I'm dedicating my poem to. And I'm also taking inspiration from a writer, Peter Balakian, and what he wrote about his poem, Head of Anahit and British Museum. So I just wanted to say that before I went in. Now I'm going to read my poem. So it's entitled Anahit's Legacy, and it's after Peter Balakian's Head of Anahit / British Museum. And of course, it's for Anush Apetyan in her memory. You said anyone could walk in, even with a sword buried underneath a charade of a chest, past rows of people, ruins, and idols, immortalized in perfect interim clay skeletons, plated in a lush bronze and dusted in an airy serpentine. Years could unfold into centuries and wrap history's carriage as precise drapery, only to lose it all in a second. To invade, to break, to ravish, to rape. My head is lost at the crossroads of tradition and change. Late July, between the dewy crossfire of burnt pots and pans spilling Vartabar water, between the local symphony of the capers of one soft street cat and another testy cur, I sat in the apricot tree's shade, branded with a khirhaj, my wrist adorned with Nazar beads tied with a silver cross. Who would have seen it coming? The autumn I left, she sickened into critical condition. Every day, a reminder, a beckoning bulletin of another. Armenian, Yazidi, atheist, man or woman, dead by proxy, beheaded, raped, mutilated. 1,000 stones would have been more humane. Nestled soundly in American dream, it all seems so far, I pretend to forget it. Your grandeur played off every church Sunday, every party, every barbecue, every shower is as good as it once was there. But my mind circles back to the lucky soldier on the 100 drum bus, the way he sat, legs glued to each other, clad in dusty military wear, as green as the most tattered mountain greens, the way his hands grip space, his arms non-existent. Today, strife like this is only natural from the myriad of relics barely stuffed behind the British Museum's walls to the postmodern fetishes of ancient culture. Anahit, who lives in the guise of Aphrodite, next to the corpses of caryatids, a token of a once great empire, stands there, fragmented. Her nose as august as ever, and her gilded hair glittered with life and granite. Trapped in a glass cage, miles from home, sold for her Hellenic grace, her magnetism, her artistry, but not for the gentle cracks that swallow her face. Thank Thank you.
I want to introduce Isabel as well. I guess I can just do a brief note before people come in. Also, I just wanted to also say you can read comments about these extraordinary new voices on HPEM as well. The comments are by the judges in the program, and I added one myself too. Isabel, we're so looking forward to hearing you.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. I just want to say before I get started that I really loved hearing everybody speak, and I'm just really grateful to be part of this experience. So I'll get right into my poem. My poem is titled Mother, My Shadow. White sheets stained with shadows, to lay where you once did, to feel the cold and heat on my skin, and to turn through the endless nights searching for God in my mind. On the right of me, fresh blood forcibly, wantingly washed away. On the left is a clean slate, the side they focus on when discussing you, if they choose to. To an untrained eye and distant ear, this was your fate, an end no one could change. Oh, how history repeats itself. Add fresh sheets, but the bed frame is all the same. I know you did not exaggerate when you spoke. Why would you, when there is already so much to say and too many to blame? I wish you knew how the echoes of our voices haunt us in the night, how our songs and screams are discernible but implausible to the acting deaf. Yet you, my mother, you tried. Even from these impenetrable walls, you crawled and you called. I may not make it clear in my foreign school or in the safe house I learned to call home, but I am fearful of change. Yet the longer it stays, I worry more with the days. And what about the world? Does it not listen? Doesn't it have eyes and ears and allies? Please, mother, do not fret any longer. I may live far and rarely pick up your calls, but I too ache with the pain that reddens your veins. I too wait for the day you are free from this cage. I too cherish the tooth that grows on your tree and tenses the land with hopes of decree. Now I see. I see how you were too hurt to scream, too low to dream, yet stood tall against the world's army. I see the nature you nurtured while nations watched us get tortured. I see the children you saved while shallow trends were made, and I've seen the posts made to boast while you prayed for the names in our toasts. I see and hear and endure this all, and I ask you, mother or mother, where did the time go? A shadow lingers, shifts right, stained with blood out of sight, and holds on to its birthright. Thank you.
Thank you, Isabel. Beautiful poem, beautiful new voices here. And we're going to, it is confirmed, Alessandra Hagobian, our honorable mention, is not here. So we're going to conclude the Young Armenian Poets Awards section of today with our last winner here, Sophia Agulik. Please unmute yourself, and we're looking forward to hearing from you. Sophia, thank you so much.
Padev, I wanted to thank all of you. It has been so inspiring to be here with such talented and thoughtful fellow Armenians, let alone having my poem selected for reading. This is just such a great privilege and honor for me. Thank you. Now I will be reading my poem called The Children of Armenia. I look at my dede's large, strong hands and see the millions of women and men who have died for our people, compared to the millions of people who have lied, who say they've helped in many ways, but in reality, reposted on Instagram and called it a day. I look at my yaya's soft and wrinkled hands, meticulously making manta, and I see in them, children in a home surrounded by fire. They reach out to us, try to hold our hands, but we simply watch, leave them stranded. They scream to us, say our name, and I say it back, a soloist in the choir. I turn around and a few more stand, but their silence is deafening. The voices of children pleading ring in my head. And suddenly they stand beside me and we become one and the chorus begins to run. We show and we share, but they don't understand. We stomp and we scream, but they only stare. We wave our flag and they say they care, but if they really did, then they would be there. So I'll paint myself purple and stand in a pot if that's what it takes to forget me not. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sophia. Shahé, over to you. We're blown away by these great new young voices, and thank you.
Yeah, I can't agree. Yeah, Alan, mesmerized by their voices. Amazing, amazing. New emerging voices, literally emerging voices. Thank you, everyone, for being with us. It's been an amazing morning, noon, afternoon, evening for all of us. Thank you to our mentors and mentees. Thank you, Olivia, for your leadership. Hovse for doing the heavy lifting behind the scenes. And thank you, writers and listeners, for being with us on a Sunday. Please donate for the fundraiser or become a member to IALA or both. Again, we appreciate your patience, and let's pray for the safety of our Artsakhi brothers and sisters in Armenia. Have a beautiful rest of your day.